Good evening, everyone. I hope you all are doing fine and keep the enthusiasm going and study really hard and well. Don't let this tough time, discourage you and demoralize you. Keep the hard work going and this too will pass. So with this, we'll start today's ICAN initiative, the Hindu and Indian Express analysis. So we'll begin today by this quote, destiny of a nation is shaped in its classrooms. This was a quote that was given as a part of the essay paper in 2017. So I have already shared another essay from part B and the introduction that I wrote in my video before. So this was the quote that I selected in the part A of the essay paper. And this just shows the importance of education in shaping the country's future and the country's destiny. So the way I began this essay was through a prayer that I was singing in my school days. So the prayer goes like this: Mandir Masjid Girija Ghar Mein Bant Diya Bhagwan Ko Dharti Banti Sagar Banta Mat Banto Insan Ko. It means that in Mandir, Masjid and Gurudwara, we have already segregated our gods. We have segregated our nations, we have segregated the seas, we have segregated everything. But at least don't segregate human beings. So I started my essay by this song, and I told that through this, I was made to sing this song in my school days, and this inculcated or this sowed the seeds of integrity, universal brotherhood and equality of all in me during the childhood days itself. So this, by this I showed how destiny of a nation could be shaped in the classrooms. So you can use such unique things to begin your essay, which will definitely earn you some brownie points. So now let's begin. And the first topic for today is the lessons that we learned from COVID-19. Now that we are facing this crisis, there will definitely be a question like, what is it going to be after the COVID? How are we going to be different as a country after we overcome this crisis? So we have several lessons that we can draw from this crisis. The first thing is the importance of Make in India. At present, we see that we are dependent on so many imports, whether even with respect to the masks or the personal protective equipments, whether it is with respect to the drugs, because for 80% of the active pharmaceutical ingredients, we are dependent on China. So we know that this dependency at such critical times is going to be very disastrous for our population. So this gives us an important lesson that we have to promote Make in India on a war footing, and then we have to encourage domestic manufacturing of several critical healthcare equipments. So at the bottom line, Make in India is very important. The second lesson that it gives is making some micro plans. We have, as a part of our disaster management, we have an act separately, but then very few containment plans or contingency plans and micro level plans regarding how, in the case of emergency, we need to handle different sections of people is not there. So we have to be able to make these micro plans so that tomorrow, in case we are faced with an emergency, we know how to deal with different sections of people, be it farmers or be it migrant laborers or anybody. And the reason why this crisis has assumed so much importance is that it has not distinguished between a prince and a pauper. It has not distinguished between regions and religions. It has shook the entire world. So at this point of time, we pose ourselves the question that post this crisis, what kind of development model are we going to adopt? So when we talk of a development model, we basically have to deal with three important arms. One is the economy, which is currently facing the recession. The other is the ecosystem, whose fragility has now, we have seen that how fragile our ecosystem is. And the third is the life or the health of our population. So these are the three critical arms in the development model that we are going to adopt after the COVID crisis. So now let's see this one by one. So when we talk about the life or the health, what this crisis has taught us is we need more doctors, we need more hospitals, we need more frontline workers at the village level. So at when we talk about this, we know that Ayushman Bharat scheme has already been launched by the government, under which 1.5 lakh health and wellness centers are going to be set up. So we have to promote all these, and we have to increase our as a percentage of GDP, how much we are allocating to health, that has to be increased. It's not just that, WHO has also recently told that 61% of, more than 60% of the deaths are happening because of the non-communicable diseases. So we have to even focus on this front. We have to adopt healthy lifestyle habits. We have to incorporate yoga, meditation, and dietary habits need to be improved. And we have to stop the sedentary lifestyle. So this is regarding the health or the life aspect in the development model after COVID. Now let's come to the ecosystem aspect. In the ecosystem aspect, WHO has given this concept of One Health. One Health means that it is a multidisciplinary approach for optimal health. So this One Health concept means that whether it is for the people or for the plant, and for the entire planet, including the animals, we need to have a development model that caters to everybody. So it is a One Health concept. And while we cater to all this to ensure that our ecosystem is robust and resilient, we also have to take the help of specialists. These specialists could be the health professionals, virologists, ecologists, or veterinarians, and so on. So One Health approach is very important to improve the robustness of our ecosystem, because it is also said that famously that there is enough for everybody's need but not for everybody's greed. So this aspect in the development model after COVID becomes extremely important. The third aspect is the economy. So when we talk about economy, there are two phases of it. One is the individual and the next is the industry. Only when the individuals demand, the industry will supply. So there has to be an equilibrium, and both of these will have to be equally focused upon. So this is about the development model that we have to adopt after the COVID. So whenever that is asked, what should be the way forward, try to incorporate these three arms in your answers, and that will make the answer more holistic as well as systematic. Alright, so what usually happens is that when we are focusing on any development model, and even now when we are dealing with this crisis, the most important thing at the end of the day is that democracy must prevail. So what Michelle Bachelet, the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, has advised the governments is that while governments are taking measures to control the virus, these measures should also keep in mind the vulnerable and the neglected people of the society. Because in democracy, democracy does not permit any trade-off. So this is very important. Democracy does not permit any trade-off. While containment measures are very important to control the virus, at the same time, we also need to weigh its impact on the vulnerable and the neglected sections of our society. For instance, the migrants. However, several nations have not followed this. Because of the crisis, several nations have assumed authoritarian powers, and this goes against the tenets of democracy. For instance, in Israel, and the Prime Minister was actually facing court cases for corruption and breach of trust. So the Prime Minister has now closed the judiciary down, and so this has also closed his own trial for now. And government has assumed immense powers of surveillance as well, and the parliament is not now allowed to meet. So in this context, what Francis Fukuyama has told becomes very relevant. He makes a distinction between rule of law and rule by law. In rule of law, it means that people are governed by the rules that are made under the constitution, which is the supreme law of the land. But rule by law means that it is made by the authoritarian or influential sections of the society according to their own wishes and their own convenience. So this should not happen. And in any development model or even during the crisis, the bottom line is that democracy must be strong and it must prevail. The next topic that we are going to take for today is the technological solutions. In a society or in any country, there are basically three very important arms. One is the government, The other is the private sector, and next is the civil society. Only when these three work in unison can we achieve any goal, and only then we can tide over any crisis. So their coordinated action and is very important. So in this case, this example illustrates the contribution made by a private sector. So in this case, it is Google. So whenever we type on Google, restaurants near me, blood banks near me, petrol pumps near me. So similarly, Google has come out with a feature in its map which says food shelters nearby a place, night shelters nearby a place. And this is important because there are several migrant and homeless laborers who are finding it very difficult to sustain themselves during the lockdown. They have to locate food, they have to locate night shelters to be able to sustain this crisis. Though I really wonder if these migrant laborers have any smartphones, but nevertheless, at least those people of us who have the smartphones can help them. So this is going to help them. So this indicates the contribution that is made by the private sector arm of this whole thing. So all of these, only when they coordinate and collaborate can we tide over any crisis. The third topic we are going to deal with is the impact of COVID on food security and agriculture. So this is a very important question for this year, that COVID has impacted our food security in agriculture. So when we talk about this again, there are three important aspects that we need to focus upon. One is the accessibility or the availability of the food. Next is the affordability of the food. And next is the impact on the farmers themselves. So these are the three aspects that need to be addressed when we talk about the impact of COVID on food security and agriculture. Now let's understand this. So first we will understand about the availability of the food. So what this says is 52% of the wheat globally is held by China. Similarly, 20% of the global rice stocks is in India. So imagine if these two countries ban exports, then what will happen to the availability of rice and wheat in the global level? Kazakhstan is a major wheat exporter and it has already banned exports. Vietnam is the third largest rice exporter and that has also stopped its exports. This will in fact reduce the global rice exports by 15%. So the nations who are sealing their borders and they're not allowing exports so as to safeguard their own population. So this will bring down the global availability of food, and particularly in those nations where the food food grains are already in less quantity. So there it could also lead to shortage and starvation. So this caters to the availability part. See, next, this whole paragraph explains the crisis in the farming very clearly. Now, let's suppose this is a farmer who is going to produce. Now, for the farmer to be able to, he has produced something and some government agencies will have to procure from the farmer. But now these government agencies are also not procuring because of the crisis. So this is not done. Secondly, there are many traders who procure directly from the farmers. Now several of these traders are not operating. Assume that these traders are operating, but then for the traders to be able to get it from the farmer, the transportation facilities are not there. The trucks are not operating. Several of these trucks are lined on the state borders and because of the lockdown. And even where the trucks are available, there are no truck drivers because these drivers are mostly migrants and they now want to go home. So they are not driving the trucks. So that is not there. And even suppose there are traders and even the truck drivers are there, let us suppose. But then the APMC mandis, they have themselves restricted the operations. And many of these farmers also sell to the retail shop outlets, and these retail outlets are now shutting down. So basically all of these is going to impact the farmer and in turn the food security and agriculture in the country because of the COVID crisis. So whenever a question is asked on the impact of COVID on agriculture, you have to address all these aspects and the three aspects of availability, affordability, and the impact on the farmer. The next important thing that we are going to see is about SAARC. There was the first virtual summit of the SAARC leaders that was held on March 15th by a video conference. So this was the initiative by the Indian Prime Minister, and this also shows the success of health diplomacy. Now let's see what is the importance of this initiative. Now the first thing is that all the eight members except Pakistan were represented at this meeting through a video conference. Second is they agreed that they need to work together to overcome this crisis. They need to share their experience and they need to share their perspectives. So this feeling was there. Thirdly, they all together established a COVID emergency fund. Okay, this was after India's proposal, and now this fund has also been operationalized. They have put together nearly $18.8 million in contribution. Though this amount is meager, but this shows the feeling of solidarity that is there in the subcontinent among the SAARC members. So when we talk of SAARC, let me also tell you a few important factual information that may be important for prelims. It was set up in December 1985 itself by Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, Maldives, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. And Afghanistan joined only in the year 2005. It has its headquarters at Kathmandu, Nepal. So this is some static information about SAARC. The next thing we're going to look at is about micro-irrigation. So why this is in news is because in the year 2019-20, Tamil Nadu has topped the All India level for the micro-irrigation coverage for this year 2019-20. So what has it done? It has done this under Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana. Apart from that, it has also given its own incentives to the farmers. For instance, it has given 100% subsidy for laying the drip irrigation system to the small and marginal farmers and 75% subsidy to the big farmers. It has also set up a management information system, an MIS. And what this MIS does is, starting from the registration of beneficiary till the release of funds, everything has now been tracked through this MIS. So this has made the process very transparent. Plus, it has also improved the speedy approval process, also has become more quicker. So this is the advantage. Also, some of these micro irrigation components, they had a GST of 12% on them. So this was a huge disincentive to the farmers to buy these micro irrigation components, and they wouldn't adopt micro irrigation. So the state has wisely absorbed this 12% GST on micro irrigation components as an incentive that farmers will come forward and they will install these systems on their farms. So when we're talking about micro irrigation, it's also important for you to know the benefits of micro irrigation, because even in the prelims, many times they have asked that which of the following is or are the benefits of micro irrigation or watershed development program or anything. So you must know basic things. See, we know that 60% of the agriculture in India is rain fed. So therefore, micro irrigation becomes extremely important. It is basically a scientific method where water and nutrients are applied directly to the root zone, drop by drop. There will be a network of pipes which are operated at low pressure, and there will be emitters which emit the waters. So the first thing is that because the water goes drop by drop, the absorption levels will be more. So there will be more absorption of water by the roots of the plants. So secondly, when the water is given drip by drip, so there won't be much of a runoff. So runoff is going to be less. Third, salinity will be less, because salinity is a condition which arises only when there is water stagnation. Because here it goes drop by drop and also is absorbed more readily by the roots of the plant, the salinity problem will reduce. Apart from this, labor cost will be saving, and fertilizers will also save on fertilizers as well, because usually with the water, fertilizers are mixed, and that's called as fertigation. So Through this, we save on fertilizers also, and farmer's income will also increase, and the irrigation water saving will also happen. So all of these are the benefits of micro-irrigation. The next thing we are going to talk about is the cyber crimes. So why this has come into news now is because now there is a lockdown, and RBI has allowed the banks a 3-month moratorium on the loan repayments. So now if I have to repay a loan, I will get a more larger window for me to repay the loan. So this is actually misused by several of these cyber criminals. What they are doing is they are calling the customers and they are saying that you are getting an extension of 3 months to repay your loans, but we are calling to verify you, verify your identity. So give us such and such an information so that we can verify. So customers are easily duped and they are revealing their information. And this whole process is called as vishing. Now let's see some basic things about phishing, vishing, and also smishing. Now let me tell you what is phishing. Phishing means, supposing you get an email which says that we are from ABC Bank and your account has been frozen, and if you want to reopen your account, click the following link, and that link is probably a malware. So there you go and you enter all the important sensitive details like the password of your accounts and all, and then money will be fraudulently taken from your account. So this is what is phishing. So phishing means that the criminals fish through your emails. Okay, they extract information from emails. That is called as phishing. When phishing is done by using voice, that is they call you either through your phone number or through WhatsApp or anything that is voice over internet. So when the same thing is done through voice, it is called as vishing, and when the same thing is done through SMS, it is called as smishing. So that is what is explained here. Alright, so now let's come to yesterday's question. Yesterday I had asked a question to analyze the relevance of the Interstate Council in the present context. So when we come to Interstate Council, first of all, it is a constitutional body that is established under Article 263 of the Constitution. It was established after the Sarkaria Commission's recommendations. So in the introduction, you are going to write what is Interstate Council, that is, it is a constitutional body, and on whose recommendations it was set up. And also, it has a threefold aim. So one is to solve any disputes between the states, and another is to promote any common interest between the states, and third is to achieve coordination in policy among the states. So these are the three important aims. So this is what is going to form your introduction. So then you will come to the body part, you will do the analysis there. So in analysis, what you're going to first write is, first you're going to tell the positives that yes, it is relevant, and then you're going to tell the negatives that where you don't find it much effective. So let's come to the positives. See, we have a Niti Aayog as well, which has a similar mandate, but then Niti Aayog is not a constitutional body. So in that case, this has the backing of a constitution, which is therefore makes Interstate Council all the more stronger constitutionally. So therefore, Interstate Council is there very much needed to achieve that interstate coordination. The second thing is that Interstate Council can be used to solve a number of issues between the states. For example, there have been issues between the center and the state regarding the role played by the governors. There have been issues regarding the usage of Article 356. Similarly, all the issues related to health, related to education, related to devolution of funds from the center to the states. Right, so all of these are the things where the Interstate Council can deliberate upon. Basically, there is this trust deficit between the center and the states, and the Interstate Council can be used to bridge this trust deficit. Also, we know that the center has exclusive powers to negotiate with a foreign government and some funding agencies. So Interstate Council can be a platform where the states can be brought on board regarding this. So these are all several issues where Interstate Council can be extremely relevant. But at the same time, it has some shortcomings. First of all, it is not a permanent body. Okay, and we need a permanent mechanism for a continuous interaction between the center and the states to be able to do any effective job. So this is not a permanent body. Second is that the meetings are not at all regular. Interstate Council met in 2016, probably after a gap of one decade. So this is very bad, and it has to meet more regularly to be able to make any meaningful contribution. Third, we have Niti Aayog, which has a similar mandate to bring the states on board and all that. And again, this might probably overshadow the Interstate Council, because Interstate Council also is not meeting. So because of all these reasons, it is not performing the role that it was envisaged to perform. So what we need at the end of the day is some reforms. Maybe give it a constitutional, make it a permanent body, make its meeting more regular, and clearly demarcate what is the function of the Niti Aayog and what is the function of the Interstate Council, so that they don't overlap and encroach upon each other. So what we need is a reforms. And finally, you conclude by saying that Interstate Council is extremely relevant, but it has to be done with certain reforms to strengthen the body. So this is how we are going to conclude it. So this is today's question. What is food security? What is its importance for India? And analyze the steps taken towards ensuring food security in India. This is a simple, straightforward question, but the challenge is to be able to write this in maybe 11-12 minutes for a 15 marker question in 250 words. That is the major challenge, because maybe you will be flooded with information when you see the question, and you may want to write everything on your paper. So in that rush, how far you will be able to justify the demand of the question is what becomes very critical. So please do write answers. Don't stop writing. All right. And one more thing that I wanted to tell you is that usually what happens is, when prelims is approaching, we stop reading newspapers. We stop following the news in general. But I have in the prelims, I have last year, for instance, I got more than 140. Before that also, I got 120, and I have always been getting above 120 in prelims. So I have comfortably able to, pass the cutoff in prelims. And one thing that I always did was, even till the day of the prelims, I kept myself aware of the latest news. So either I used to flip through the newspaper pages, or I would listen to some summaries online, but I always kept myself updated. And this really helped me, because these days the kind of questions that are asked in prelims, some of the facts you may not even remember, even if you read it from a test series or anything. But somehow I felt that these news that I kept myself updated about, they helped me to eliminate so many statements in the MCQs and arrive at the right answer. Because what is most important in prelims is not that you should know the right answer, but you must be able to eliminate the wrong answers. So in this process, newspaper reading helped me a lot. So I request and I urge you that you please keep yourself updated with the newspapers no matter what, and don't think that how you're going to use it in the exam, because question papers will be set and you don't have to really keep abreast with the newspapers. Don't think about that, but trust me that this is going to be helpful, and spending half an hour a day is not a big deal. Even if it is going to help you in one or two questions, it is really important. All right, so that's all today. Thank you.